Good afternoon, everyone. Bonjour tout le monde. Moi, je suis Paul Landry, directeur.
I'm Paul Landry, director general for the Atlantic for Canadian Heritage. Welcome to this session.
Organized throughout the country. Nous avons aujourd'hui avec nous.
We have today with us the Honorable Mélanie Joly, Minister for Canadian Heritage. The Honorable Dominique Leblanc, Government Leader of the House of Commons and Minister for Fisheries and Oceans and the Coastal Guard, and Jeanette Petitpas-Taylor, who's the member, the MP for Moncton.
Presence of the new Mayor of the City of Moncton, Don Arnold, et le recteur de l'Université de Moncton, M. Tiverge. Bienvenue. Nous avons également avec nous Jean-Pierre.
We also have Jean-Pierre Gauthier, who's Director General for Official Languages at Canadian Heritage.
Simultaneous translation today so that everyone can express themselves in the language of their choice. Number one is English and number two is French. J'inviterai maintenant tous.
Now I would like to invite all participants to introduce themselves, to tell us your name and the organization that you're representing.
Around the table, introduce themselves, your name as well as the organization you represent. And for the ease of knowing who wants to speak, if you could make sure that your little folders, your name tags are, that we can see them well in the front. S'il vous plaît, assurez-vous qu'on puisse voir.
So make sure we can read your names.
À ma gauche ici.
So begin with Mr. Tiverge.
Bonjour, Gino Leblanc.
Of Moncton. Gino Leblanc, University of Moncton. Hello, Marie Missitin, Director General of the Center for Francophone Immigrants here in Moncton. I'm Micheline Gaupolin, President of the Board for the Health Network. I'm Alexis Couture. I represent the Association of French-speaking lawyers. I'm Jean Farrand, President of the Art Center for Dieppe.
I represent the Anglophone Rights Association of New Brunswick.
Microphone, please. Microphone, please. Sorry, the interpreter did not hear her. I'm Ghislaine Foulaine, President for the Literacy Council of New Brunswick. I'm Chantal Larrain, Francophone Association of Parents in New Brunswick. Philippe Beaulieu, President of the Société de l'Acadie of New Brunswick. Don Arnold, I'm the Mayor of Moncton.
Of Dialogue New Brunswick.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Sue.
I'm Sue Duguay, President of the Federation of Young Francophones of New Brunswick. Paul Demers, President of the Education Council for New Brunswick. Calvin Gibb, Director General of the Acadian Society. I'm Chantal Lousier, Policy Analyst for the for New Brunswick. And now I'd like to invite Jeanette Petitpas-Taylor to say a few words. Thank you. Well, first, welcome to all of you. Thank you for taking time to come here and dialogue with us. Also, special greeting to Minister Joly. We're very happy to have you with us, and it was great to have you with us yesterday.
Coming here today, we really want to hear all of your ideas and have a really good exchange this afternoon. So I'm sure we're going to have some fruitful discussions. So thank you.
Merci. Je demanderai maintenant au ministre.
I'd like now Minister Leblanc to say a few words. Thank you, Paul. Hello, Mélanie. Welcome to Acadie. Like Jeanette said, it was your first tentamen yesterday. That was an experience you had to live through. I'm very happy to have you with us. just a few words to our guests. Melanie and I, we have mutual friends, been mutual friends for a long time. We're very lucky to have her as a Minister for Canadian Heritage. It is a person who knows linguistic communities. She's very much involved in the cause of minority linguistic groups, and as a Canadian who represents some 50 towns in New Brunswick, I cannot imagine a better person to have someone at the helm of official languages. At this time, our government is elaborating this new plan for official languages, and I know that Melanie will be talking to you about that. And it's a privilege to have her with us in the CADI and to work with you as well. We're, as Jeanette said, we're lucky to have such a representative group this afternoon of the representative of the Acadian Francophone community. So we're very much involved in official languages programs, and it will be a privilege to work with you in the coming years. Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Gilly, to say a few words.
Merci beaucoup.
Thank you. Thank you, Jeanette, Dominique. Thank you for being here, and thank you for your help in official languages. I know that you are good allies for me in caucus and in cabinet, and thank you all for being here. And I thought I would go through several points on what we are about to do today and what we're doing right now across Canada. So essentially, we have those consultations all over Canada. We started in June, I believe, and we decided that time to break with tradition and make those consultations about official languages, make them open to the public through the web, now we have to have public consultation according to the Official Languages Act, and it's the first time we do this since we've had action plans, and for the first time they're open to everybody, to the general public. Also, what we want to do is prepare the new action plan for official languages that will be effective in 2018. So what we're elaborating is what we have now is the roadmap from 2013, and the next year we'll be elaborating the new program. And to me, it's more than a roadmap. It's more like our game plan.
Well, bilingualism is at the basis of a social contract we have in this country, where the vitality of linguistic communities, which are in minority situations, is protected by law, is protected by our charter, and of course in our constitution. So bilingualism is not a question and is not questionable. Et donc c'est pour ça aujourd'hui je veux vous en.
It's for that reason that I want to hear your views on how to make sure that we strengthen the vitality of minority linguistic groups. And even before having this game plan, we've already acted. Three things we've done. One, regarding Francophone immigration, I worked with John McCallum to make sure that we would have this program significant advantage Francophone, so that we will have more Francophone immigrants who will be integrated within the minority linguistic groups. And John and me worked on that after the Syrian refugee crisis. And as you know, we had 25,000 new refugees, and because of the concerns of various communities and now in the past, the funding for Francophone immigration had been canceled, and we relaunched that. And with the Minister of Defense, we reestablished the Francophone program in Saint-Jean, near Montreal, so that we train our officers in French. Also, we we invested almost $700 million in CBC, so that we have more local content in both official languages across the country. And fourth example, if I may, I've worked with my team to kickstart the court challenges program to make sure that the rights of linguistic minorities are well protected in that context. Now, last point.
Work with my deputy minister when I was first elected, and I was very much preoccupied by the fact that the money was going to organizations very, the process was too fastidious, was too long, and I really wanted to make sure that we could do better when it came to making sure to help in terms of budgeting and preservability of funding. So what happened is, en tant que ministre du patrimoine canadien.
And as Minister for Canadian Heritage, I have 8,000 contributions and grants to sign off on. So that's, of course, that's a lot. And so that would mean about 30 signatures a day. So I was at the Aberdeen Centre. I was in Caraquet, so I would have had trouble signing my 30 signatures. And during the tentamen, it would have been quite a hassle yesterday to sign, 30 grants and agreements. And, just finding the place to do that would have been hard. We're trying here to narrow this down. And so all those amounts of $70,000 and less that are grants and contribution agreements, all that was delegated to the regional authorities within the country, and it's the first time in the history of the minister of the department that it's done. That means that you will be getting your checks one month or 2 months earlier, so you don't have to fund your own operations while you're awaiting the check from Canadian Heritage, and the event has already taken place. You'll be able to talking with Paul about the multi-annual funding. So we are taking politics out of grants and contribution agreements. All that was our aim was to diminish the waiting time and provide you with a better service.
To listen to all of you and to react to what you have to say. Certainement, ce qu'on remarque.
As a tendency that we observe across the country is that there's the matter of vitality of linguistic minorities, but there are new phenomena. For instance, the integration of new immigrants, media as well, how to maintain the media in those communities. And I know that these two questions will be important here too, and also the need to have community infrastructures. So I'll be taking notes. Okay? Thank you, Minister. Jean-Pierre Gauthier will explain to you how this all this will unfold. Thank you very much for being with us this afternoon. I'll explain to you briefly what we'll be doing this afternoon.
The roundtable is going to be about 2 hours long. We'll have until 1600, 4 o'clock this afternoon, to have the table. The discussion will be recorded and transcribed, so I invite you to use the microphone at all times. It will be transcribed for analysis purposes back at the office. The team will gather all the information, that whether it's coming from roundtables, from submissions you may produce to us in hand-to-hand or over the internet, or the comments we're going to get from people online watching us, and so on and so forth. So everything will be gathered and analyzed together to give us a very good account of all that's, of all what we're going to hear today and during the whole summer of official languages. Avec l'invitation, vous.
Now, with your invitation, you received questions, and that was to. So we will not follow them, by the book. But there are two questions that are important. One is, how are you? How are you doing? Are you doing? And so, how do you manage in your day-to-day life? And also, regarding the country, what is your view on this? So, first question is, how are you? And we want to hear your testimonies. The third question, the longest one, with all the sub-questions. What can the Government of Canada do to better, innovate with respect to official languages? There are other thematic questions, just to make sure that we deal with questions on which we want to hear your point of view. But you already have an idea of the areas that are of interest to us. I remind you that there's a an online survey. You're all invited to participate. Tell your friends.
Take the survey online. This is part of the subject will be all analyzed together. You can also file a memorandum. You can aussi déposer un mémoire.
You can also send a submission online, long, short, whatever. Everything will help. Now, there's something peculiar. Normally, in round tables, we invite people to turn off their phones. Now it's the opposite. You can let them keep them open. You can take pictures, make a comment, or whatever. This can be sent on social media. Now, I must be getting old because I'm asking you to keep your cell phones open.
You need to have a chance to speak and to go around the table. You want to have this much more as an informal discussion, as a series of interventions. So I will be measuring time. I will be giving 3 minutes to everyone. Et quand j'arrive à peu près à 30 secondes de la fin, je vais vous demander...
And 30 seconds from before the end, I'll ask you to wrap up. And we've already done 3 or 4 round tables. So this is the fourth one we're doing in the Atlantic region. I know that you people are raconteurs. I'm sure this is no surprise for you to hear that. But 30 seconds before the end, I'll ask you to wrap up and we'll be going to the next intervener. And everybody will have a chance to say a few words. Some will have more than once the opportunity to say something.
Today. You good to proceed? Okay. Donc, sans faire plus.
So, without further ado, I'd like. Do we have a volunteer to break the ice? Is it Tiberge? Welcome to the University of Moncton to answer the first two questions. So what is the situation regarding official languages? Now, I've lived in 4 provinces, Ontario, Manitoba, Quebec, and New Brunswick. I've known the linguistic minority is in those regions, and there's a slipping here regarding the vitality. And that is due to various factors, and we won't debate them today necessarily, that is weakening that ethno-linguistic vitality. But we have some data that proves that there are some factors that have an extraordinary impact on the vitality of the French language as well. We want to have an action plan. I think we should rethink the whole governance system for official languages. We've had the same system for 40 years. I don't have a new model to propose, but I think it is time to rethink the model that we have. Now, we talk a lot about governments and transparency, and that's good. But it's I think it should be done for this new plan. Regarding post-secondary institutions, we are at the very end of the learning spectrum. Very often in our community, so we should have plans in place for from kindergarten all the way to university, and we should have access to the same kind of programs that the majority English speakers for. The University of Moncton, we have to offer all programs, and if we can't, then our students would have the choice. And also, we have to have better knowledge and to have better policies for that. It is extremely important that we reinforce the capacity. 30 seconds. We have to work more with the private enterprise. and we must reinforce linguistic duality, and we should have a pan-Canadian campaign to do that and to enhance the contribution of minority groups. You go from Vancouver to Bouctouche, you will see that there are places that the French does not exist. French is not present, as you know. Thank you, Raymond.
Monsieur Chantal.
Yes, my name is Chantal from the Economic Council of New Brunswick, and I represent Francophone areas across the province. Let's talk about the Francophone business community. Obvious for us, it's not a matter of whether French or English is important. The question we would ask is, how can we ensure that bilingualism becomes a reality in the business world, because Francophone business persons deal not only with New Brunswickers, they have dealings across Canada and throughout the world. So a Francophone community is an advantage, and it's a door that is open to all Canadians, to all Anglophone businesses also across Canada, but also throughout the world. So in your action plan, how can we add economic bilingualism and ensure that when we think about increasing our market provincially, nationally, or internationally, how can we make that advantage known? It is an economic advantage. And most Francophones are in the northern part of New Brunswick and in rural areas, and these Francophone business persons are doing a wonderful job. It's amazing to see what they're doing as businesses. Quebec is next door. So every 2 years, we have a meeting with Quebec, and Francophone entrepreneurs from New Brunswick and from Quebec get together, and they do business. And today, since 2004, for example, this meeting between Acadie and Quebec has been useful, and the Quebec say, they say that 90% of those involved say it's very important to have this meeting, to have this openness as far as bilingualism is concerned, and we're also very close to the United States. So how can we make that economic advantage known in the game plan? How can we make it an asset, an economic asset? Thank you very much. Patrick?
Thank you. I'm okay with that. And as a co-chair of Dialogue New Brunswick, I'll just quickly tell you that my great-grandfather was Alphonse Brun. And I became an O'Brien because a Frenchman who cut wood in Capelet couldn't get a job in St. John. So he pretended he was mute and added an O on the front. So such is life. I, too, have lived in five provinces and have enjoyed various careers in government, and accept and respect the fact that sometimes, because of my chosen circumstances, there will be career limitations because people have a right to be served in their language of choice. So I guide my life accordingly. I feel things are okay because I allow myself to feel welcome. I'm in the heart of Acadia here. I'm unilingual. Half of my friends are Francophone. I live in and have lived in Moncton since 98 and feel most welcome here. So I need to make that point. And it's for that reason that I've become part of Dialogue New Brunswick. And if I can cut to the chase so I don't get the 30-second hook, is that we need some help. We have to be able to change the narrative. We have to be able to find some evidence-based research, if you will, that'll help us move that yardstick in terms of social cohesion. Right now, the debate has become politicized so often because we get identified with government. Dialogue New Brunswick's been around for 25 years. It has outlived all the previous Tory governments. It's outlived Liberal governments, and who knows what's in store down the road. So our work is to try to do, as I say, evidence-based, community-owned, depoliticized activities that promote social cohesion so we can flush out a few people like myself who don't mind getting to enjoy the richness of the New Brunswick culture and wherever else it takes you. I won't speak for my Anglophone brother, the new mayor of Fredericton, but we're in the same boat. And he celebrated August 15th yesterday at City Hall, I see. So look to organizations like us to be grassroots, to be connected, to find unique, interesting ways to connect the community so people understand each other and celebrate and reinforce what we have to offer. 30 seconds.
Yes, almost. Pretty good. Somebody else? Quelqu'un d'autre? On avait Carmen.
Bonjour.
Yes, good afternoon. I don't remember the official name, but in the official languages action plan, we have Acadie, New Brunswick. We have the same envelope for the different sectors of activity, but we've had the same amount for many years now. I've been working there now for 17 years, and we've had no increase. And there's some inequality here because there are several Acadians in the same area, and we have the same amount of money. We don't have the same amount as other provinces where there are fewer jobs, for example. There is inequality here. And we need the funds in order to support development and the role that is played by community organizations. And this official languages plan, we need support under the plan, and I think it's very important. Investments have been made, and Madame Jolie, I would like to point the 1.8 billion you invested. 1.9 in fact. So that's wonderful. And that's what we've been hearing now for a long time. A lot of people have been talking about that. But now we have a fund, an investment, to improve the situation at Radio-Canada, CBC, making it possible to have a better reflection of Acadians, a better window onto the world. And we want to ensure equality so that we can produce our shows here. We don't want to be equal with Montreal, but we want to show that we have a window on the world. We want to show what we're doing here, and I would like to strongly encourage you to come up with a national federal culture policy. It's time for us to have such a policy, and that will direct arts and culture and guide us in our development for Canada. And I would just like to see a professional plan for community cultural action. We want to have such a community fund, and we want to see the professional arts reflected in that fund. Thank you very much, Carmen. Yes, you did respect the time. Philippe? Well, what I've just heard I find very encouraging, especially as far as future plans are concerned. But I would like to express my great disappointment, that is concerning the broadcast of the Acadian National Holiday on CBC. It was in a replay, but we don't have a replay of the Saint-Jean-Baptiste festivities. When we're talking about promotion and linguistic equality, we also want to have our window on the world. We want to be seen on our national broadcaster. And also when it comes to the application of official languages, I think there's a notion that's very important here, that at the basis of everything, languages are not only there to allow for the survival of the communities in a minority situation, but to allow for the development and the evolution of those communities. And I think that includes, and it calls for a greater dialogue between the federal government and communities in a minority situation in order to ensure that we do have development. And something else, and I'll be very quick here. We don't do enough promotion on the why of official languages and bilingualism. So there are situations in which some people feel isolated, but they should be able to understand the basis of the Official Languages Act and why we have bilingualism. It didn't just happen. It's a fundamental right in this country. If you look throughout history, the Francophone community, the Quebecois, Acadians, we all played a fundamental role, just as did the Irish, the Scotch, and so on. So as the federal government did with participation, it should launch a national campaign in newspapers, on TV, on radio, and so on, to explain what the Official Language Act is and why it does exist, so that everyone understands that it's for communities in a minority situation, for Francophones and for Anglophones who are living in a minority situation. And I'll stop here for the time being because I got the 30-second look. Yes, in fact. Thank you very much, Philippe. Ghislaine? Yes, thank you. I would like to follow up on what the president of the Université de Moncton said concerning the need for basic financing and basic programming for organizations. Canadian Heritage was ensuring basic financing for organizations, but at one point, under Part 7 of the Official Languages, we had other departments, justice and so on. There was something for literacy, and that allowed organizations to get basic funding other auspices, and a lot fell by the wayside. So certain departments also contribute to helping organizations with their basic funding. Canadian Heritage cannot fully meet the needs of all communities currently. As far as the literacy situation is concerned, 62% of Francophones have difficulty reading or understanding what they read. Perhaps there's even a lower rate in English because they chose to complete the survey in French. So it's very important to offer Francophones in a minority situation an opportunity to develop their skills and to be able to live in their own language, the language of their choice, and that is French. As for minority language situations, it's very difficult to live in French in most of the province. For example, English is the predominant language in work. Only 32% of people who do not use English in a work situation. We're talking about an important economic and cultural right for Francophones, and most of them have difficulty developing skills in the language of their choice. We feel that the government should support community efforts by mobilizing the various government departments so they work together in order to improve the level of literacy and the skills of Francophone adults who are living in a minority situation. And we do think, however, that programs should meet the needs of the community rather than administrative criteria, which is often the government agenda. Yes, we have to be able to take advantage of our investments by supporting Francophones in a minority situation. And it's especially important to support the development of family literacy programs, especially with low literacy Francophone families. 30 seconds. So family literacy would encourage a learning environment for Francophones, and they would have that support throughout their life. And if we provide services to Francophones in their language, then we can allow for a reflection and a better relationship among themselves between both cultures. So our recommendation, adapt federal programs to the community and not to the government agenda, especially emphasizing family literacy in French, so federal services can make it possible to develop French projects over the long term, and that because of solid basic funding. So for those who have documents to present, you can share them with us, and we'll incorporate it in the consultations. Today, yes, I can take your briefs today, if you will, or you can send them in by email. Thank you, because the document is more complete than what I said. Yes, we'll look forward to that. So a final comment before I go online, and then we have two other names, four other names on the list of people who would like to speak. Gino? Yes, thank you. I think that everything that's been said up until now represents a piece of the puzzle. It's my first comment. And I would like to emphasize political leadership here, not in a partisan way, but Mr. Jolie should emphasize leadership within government. We're talking about a project, a particular file, but when ministers go back to cabinet and when they go into cabinet committees, the game is also played at that level, and we need your support here. Once upon a time, we remember that at the Privy Council, at the Treasury Board, and even in the Prime Minister's office, we had more resources working on official languages issues. And I think that would be an interesting model to take up again, going back 10 or 15 years here. When it comes to bilingualism and Acadie, it's all part of history, but it's also part of the future of the country. So you were talking about social contract, Madam Minister, and Philip mentioned this. I would talk about social marketing. We have to get that message out. Mr. Bryan mentioned the same thing, essentially. This social contract is part of our fundamental values. We're not just talking about advantages or money or assets or special treatment. We're talking about who we are fundamentally as Canadian. It's part of the initial deal. So I think there should be, in the Jolie Action Plan, room for this, more support, more programs, in order to reflect the importance of official languages at the center. When you go back to your cabinet meetings, your committee meetings, and so on, who's responsible for official languages? Not just Minister Jolie. You have to have a committee leadership at that level. And I would have other comments to make perhaps later on. Yes, two comments that we received online. And once again, I would like to ask the people who are listening online, please do not hesitate to make comments.
C'est qu'ils read them into the record once in a while. Le premier commentaire que j'aurais, c'est donc un commentaire.
So the first comment, continue to financially support different programs through Canadian Heritage. Congratulations for the Pan-Canadian consultations.
Which basically, and I will, I'm summarizing the comments because sometimes it can be a bit long, but that Canada needs to make sure that we're not discriminating against any official languages while applying policies and laws for minority languages, and to be careful not to cause any tension between the groups because of that. So that's another comment we got online as well. Now, for next speaker, I think, Rex, you were next in line.
Talk about a black sheep showing up here. I am a unilingual English speaker representing the majority at a conference on minority rights, etc. I want to also mention then that I was I was asked to come here. I didn't butt my way in to come here. There's a few things. In a way, having somebody here to represent the majority probably has some benefit. I came here prepared to follow that list of questions that I was given, and we've kind of thrown that out the window, so I'm kind of winging it here. First of all, I have a quote that is very strange the way this turned out, but it sums up a lot of what the English-speaking group that I represent believe in. And it's probably for the Francophone minority in this province probably very unbelievable. And because we get press that paints us in the wrong light. You probably know who you will have recognized who said this in response in comments supporting a bill in the legislature in New Brunswick, and the quote is as follows. The aim of this bill is the extension of rights for all New Brunswickers. It in no way diminishes rights now enjoyed by New Brunswickers. On an individual basis, it is the right of New Brunswickers to be and remain unilingual or to speak two or more languages. The objective is to ensure that no unilingual New Brunswicker finds himself at a disadvantage in participating and in the public life of our province. With respect to the civil service, the fact that a man or a woman is unilingual will not be a hindrance to the appointment and promotion in the civil service or other qualification, while other qualifications being equal.
30 seconds, Rex.
I think this is a fair bill, and if all is treated fairly, implemented fairly, and harmoniously, I believe it will lead to a much better understanding. And that was stated by Premier Louis Robichaud, in introducing the Bill 73 of the Official Languages in 1969. And that, because I'm out of time, that is basically what we support, that type of take on the Official Languages Act. Thank you.
Thank you, Rex. Ensuite, j'ai Paul qui voulait prendre la parole.
Paul? Yes, good afternoon. Well, as the president of the Francophone Education Council in the southern part of the province, our concern deals with the official languages program in education. And the National Federation of Francophone School Boards has the same concern. Currently, the protocol does not meet the needs of Francophone and Acadian communities in a minority situation when it comes to education in French. And there are three major gaps here. The first gap is that currently nothing has been negotiated with the National Federation, so nothing has been signed. The Federation, in 2018, when the plan is renewed, the National Federation should become signatory of the protocol specifically dealing with education in French as a first language. The protocol would apply to the fund that would supplement instruction in the language of the minority managed by Francophone school boards in a minority situation. Earlier we talked about the charter, and I think Section 23 of the charter is very important here. It is inconceivable to conclude agreements and not have the Fédération Nationale there to represent the 28 Francophone school boards across Canada. I think it's very important. And the other gap, we have to call for complete accountability on the part of departments of education. And this full accountability is impossible for Francophone and Acadian communities in a minority situation because they cannot determine the purposes for which the monies are used. So we have to know where these monies are going. And we have an overall view, an overall idea, but we don't have the specifics. So accountability remains a very important point for me. And the third gap, a protocol that allows for an adequate consultation process with Acadian and Francophone communities in a minority situation. So the protocol allows the Government of Canada, provinces, and territories to consult, 30 seconds, to consult the Francophone and Acadian communities in a minority situation, but only when they feel it's necessary. So it shouldn't be only when it's necessary, it should be always, and it should become a practice under a new framework. Thank you very much, Paul. And I have some other people who would like to speak. Jean-Soum Nera, Micheline, Don, and then I see two other hands, Chantal and Iote. Thank you. So, yes, thank you very much. As far as young people are concerned, I would like to add a bit to what has been said. There's the point on linguistic insecurity, and that's very important. So at a very young age, you want to be accepted by your peers, you want to be popular, you want to find your own place, and that leads to linguistic insecurity. So in provinces such as New Brunswick, where French is not spoken everywhere, it's difficult to find a solution to that problem of being accepted as a young person. I live in Miramichi, which is an Anglophone city, and when I say thank you at a shop, I'm trying to find the courage to say merci and to give young people the confidence that they need in order to say merci instead of thank you in a shop, or to say thank you in the Acadian Peninsula instead of merci, because it's very difficult to find your place as a young person doing that. And at the Federation of Young Francophones in New Brunswick, we're going to have a tour on linguistic duality in our province, and in order to be able to understand each other, so there would be no problem situation, we have to understand that communication is the key, because we are in a bilingual country. English and French are the official languages, and we want to ensure, and I like to compare here language courses that we have. For example, in a French school, young people have to be able to learn English and be comfortable speaking English. They can do that, but the contrary is not also true. There is French immersion, and Anglophones are not comfortable communicating in French as I'm comfortable communicating in English. So to wrap up, I think we have to give young people the confidence to be able to communicate in the language of their choice when they want and where they want across our country, and that would be great if we could do that. Thank you very much, Sue. Next. Yes, I just wanted to add, 30 seconds. Yes, I would just like to add to what you said, that, and also generally to comments made around the table. Obviously, the future action plan on official languages will support the 2 points, the vitality of linguistic communities in a minority situation, and secondly, support for bilingualism and social cohesion.
How we see it is that there's no competition between ensuring a vitality, the vitality of our linguistic communities, and at the same time to promote bilingualism. So that's in order to make sure that there's greater social cohesion, to also, Sue, what you were saying, greater linguistic security or confidence, and therefore stronger communities throughout the country. Yes.
Alors, Marge, je te redonne la parole.
Yes, I just wanted to add a point on Francophone immigration, which seemed to be an important point in the bilingualism plan. Immigrants choose Canada because it is a bilingual country. That's a reality. And once they arrive here, very often, they find that bilingualism can be an obstacle because they really don't understand what role they can play as a Francophone coming from outside. So there are two levels of difficulty for a Francophone coming from outside. First difficulty, should I educate my children in English because I want to give them every possible opportunity to integrate economically? And secondly, instead of improving their French, I'll send my children to English school. There is an education program. And I agree with my neighbor here on the right that the bilingualism right takes several stakeholders. And I think, based on what I see and hear from immigrants, is that the education program should be a stakeholder. So that comes back to the economic issue. I'm a Francophone, but how can I integrate economically without obviously always speaking English? And in fact, yes, we can be a Francophone, unilingual, just as we can be unilingual Anglophone, but how can I offer what I have to offer because I was chosen to contribute to the wealth of this country. So those are the two aspects. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup, Mayor.
Thank you. Now, we have Micheline. Thank you, Minister. I had this presentation it was supposed to last 5 minutes, but, I'll try to reduce that to 3 minutes. You wanted us to talk about the health of French and health in French. One of the biggest determinants for our health is to have a service in your language, in French, and that's one of the big determinants here. With regards to our own network, Health and Vitality, we offer services to 238,000 people. Our services are totally bilingual, and we have very, very few complaints regarding the services that we offer, because they are bilingual. Now, with regards to the challenges that we do have, we have some catch-up to do. The French network has less resources than the English network, and as a rule, the specialized care is mostly in Anglophone areas. So there's a lot of catching up to do, and that should be one of our main objectives in the next 5 years. We'll do this catching up for both the linguistic communities. And I want to reassure all of those people here that we're taking nothing away from the Anglophone sector. It's only a matter of catching up. We have to consolidate. We have only one university hospital. It has to be consolidated and it has to be strengthened. And we have to consolidate our research activities. The other ministers should be involved here. We have to train other health professionals, and we've shown here that we can do some very high caliber research, and we must diversify our research centers and be able to build new ones. To talk about challenges now, well, I'll say this. I would not be helping your consultation in New Brunswick if I did not talk about the risks that we foresee. The biggest risk is the loss of control of governance. 30 seconds. There is a wave of privatization, of provincialization as well, that is such that we want only one provincial program that will be privatized. And in many cases, French is totally forgotten in that. It's not a priority, and the programs are streamlined in English only. So the health support system is extremely important for the whole community, and we have to have a global approach here, and we must work in collaboration with people from Moncton University and other institutions, and we must do that for clinical services as well. So, just to make sure, I have Dawn, Chantal, and Nathalie, and we have some few comments online that Paul will be reading in a few minutes. Let's go. Thank you.
A snobby upper Canadian who chose to live here. I know, who chose to live here and now self-identify as a value-added Acadian. So I just wanted to give you that context. I've heard a lot of people, in fact, I've heard Jeanette say this, I think it came from our Prime Minister, that the world needs more Canada. Well, I would argue that Canada needs more Moncton, because we are doing this right. We are living bilingualism in such a meaningful way every single day in everything that we do. En fait, la ville de Moncton est...
And officially, the city of Moncton is bilingual, so we do live that. And
increasingly, we're finding that immigrants, as Maha said, I mean, are choosing also to come to Moncton, whether they're Korean, Chinese, Syrian, and they want their children to grow up trilingual.
I had the great privilege of being very involved in the Fry Festival, Canada's only bilingual international literary festival. And in the context of that, over the last 16 years, I had the opportunity to meet authors from around the world that could not believe the linguistic capabilities in our city and how we lived in such harmony. And I think that we sometimes forget how special Canada is, and New Brunswick in particular, and Moncton even more so, that we have something amazing in this report, which talks about equality, support for those for our community to create that vitality of bringing the two communities together in meaningful ways, and to celebrate what we have here, as well that sense of belonging and creating that sense of belonging in these in our community. So we're really living it, but we're also really encouraged and want to advance this to the next level, and that we have a whole plan of how we will make that happen in our community. Thank you.
Thank you, Don. À la suite, j'ai Chantal.
No, Chantal. Thank you. I will not be repeating what's been said, but what I want to talk about is that there are limits regarding bilingualism and French schooling. Parents do not really understand the construction of identity, and we don't always have the services for that. And if it's not done, well, the people will choose, there's less chances that the parents will choose Francophone schools and Francophone childcare for their children. And family and schooling is indispensable when you think of the promotion of kids and their encouragement to advance. And so we have here elements of a solution with regards to the attachment to language and culture. And we want the federal government to be a partner of parents in a minority context within this country, and that in two main files. One is early childhood. We should be more transparent in the federal provincial agreements so that parents are really consulted, and this way money will be invested meaningfully. And we must manage also the data to feed the strategies that we have and encourage early childhood development. Now, with regards to Francophone parents, and helping them, we must have some initiatives, but also make sure that these initiatives will last. That's a big challenge in all community organizations. We are funded to begin with, and sometimes we have one employee, sometimes we have more, if we're lucky, but we must always renew their projects, and that's difficult. And its dissemination becomes difficult, and for the transmission of language and culture, the development of cultural identity for generations to come. And we saw your report on the transmission of language. Your minister produced a wonderful report on that. So we must help more the Anglophone parent in the transmission of French and the transmission of the Francophone identity of children. 30 seconds, and so you must better the partnership that you have for official languages in order to support more Francophone families and provide them with better services in French. Thank you. Ralph Goodale, you'll take a 50-second statement and do it in 20 seconds. So congratulations. So Natalie, you're next. Then Paul has online comments. Hello, I'm Natalie Leblanc. I'm here because I represent the region of Chédiac, Grand Cap-Pelé, Barachois. What I see here is a lot of provincial groups, so it's a bit stressful for me to be representing a small organization of a region. Now, I'm here because I hope that since we do community development, and you talked about that, Minister Jolie, and that's what we do. We have this cultural society. We work in very rural areas. That's our daily bread. On top of that, I'd like to say that there's an emergency, and we must fund even infrastructures or community infrastructures, and we get our money from your department for the community life. And again, we need money, and but we mostly have volunteers around at the table, and so we're very close to our communities. And I say all that, and I'm sure you've heard that before. Oh, they want more money, blah, blah, blah. But no, we're very proud of what we're doing in our communities, and we're next to, Mr. and Mrs. Joe Public. The communities are important, and we are there to help them. So please support us further, and I could be talking about cultural societies, but to me, community infrastructure is far more important. We also answered questions, and we'll have a submission on that later. But Canada is a country that's officially bilingual, so bilingualism is very important. And I'm very proud of bilingual too, as Don was saying. Now you can live in the language of your choice. If you're willing to use your second language every day, and that's what we do every day in the southeast New Brunswick, but I can do it, and I'm very proud of that. Now, if you relate that to culture, how to make sure that both communities come together? Well, we must encourage cultural exchanges, and these programs should begin when kids are very young. And you will have more positive results because families will be meeting in the framework of those exchanges. And so then you have Francophone and Anglophone families that talk to each other. They have cultural activities together. 30 seconds, Nathalie. Yes, thank you. And to wrap up, infrastructures are very important. Thank you. Thank you, Nathalie. Now I'll ask Paul to tell us what we have online.
That touch free language classes. This individual is saying very much like to improve his or her French-speaking abilities and is wondering what government funds resources are available to assume that. The second comment is action plan for minority language communities, much include investments to rebuild community-based literacy capacity and widen beyond workplace skill development. Et la troisième et dernière pour l'instant.
And third one, and last, the government of Canada should be making the population aware of duality and of the good side of duality, and we must make sure that the two communities understand each other better. Thank you. Thank you. So I heard you. And that you've dealt with many subjects, for instance, your relationship with the education ministry, to have more transparency regarding federal transfers, to have a national policy for culture, for infrastructure. You mentioned that too, Nathalie. Now, I haven't heard you about the media aspect, and I'd like to hear your opinion. How do you do you find information? How do you support artists? Do you go to shows, for instance? That's the first point. Now, the access to justice. It might be interesting to hear you on that for the access to justice in French. And the final point. Transportation. That's another question. We have, because we, the federal government, have a stake in there. Now, for Jean, Carmen, Rex, and Philippe. Now, everybody has had a chance, but if we see someone who has not spoken, that person will have the priority. But there's only Jean and Alexis, so that everyone has had a chance. Jean will begin with you, all right? Thank you. Regarding participation of communities, I'm the president of the Arts Council of Dieppe, so it is quite a narrow niche, but our vitality is based on the fact that a lot of people work in their own domain, arts or education, and they work a lot with volunteers, and so we must give more tools to those volunteers, because we have now a new generation that does not work the same way that we did, and we see that at the Arts and Culture Center. We have good participation, we have a lot of people, and but now we want to know, what do the kids want to see? Is that what our communities want to see? And I think it's important for us here and elsewhere. We should be diagnosing what are the needs of our community. And also we have to open a window on new immigrants and the Anglophones, because they all have this potential to enrich us. We can enrich our diversity, and we're mature enough, you know, to work with other communities. And but first, we have to know what we have to offer, and what they would like to see. That's important. The second thing: how can we go beyond perceptions? We talked about media. Well, what you see in media are often opinions and perceptions. And what we should do is break those perceptions. For instance, the information that you sent us, I had not seen that before, and yet I'm well read, I think, and I follow current events. But we don't have enough positive data coming out of Canadian heritage. You want to celebrate? Okay, well, let's celebrate the reality and not perceptions. And very often our decisions are based on perceptions or unfounded data, because people have certain idea of what the situation is, and it's often wrong. So with the support of our government, we could have a better message and change the perceptions of about what bilingualism is all about in this country. Thank you. Alexis, your turn. Gino talked earlier about political leadership. It's very important regarding official languages, and it's important to have champions. Now, in Moncton, we have a mayor who's very much involved. I hope we'll have the same luck at the federal level. And it's important also to go beyond Canadian heritage now, at the Justice Department, which it would be nice to be as well greeted at Justice as we are at Canadian Heritage. I'm not saying that we're not well greeted, but you know, they should have this understanding all throughout the federal government, because they all have a role to play. The second thing, we should allow our organizations to contribute to the vitality of our linguistic groups. And there are many groups right now who are more of a survival mode instead of contribution mode, and that's too bad. Again, it's a matter of having the means to grow. We don't want to have a jet plane yacht. No, we want some basic multi-annual funding to allow our organizations to develop further. And the French-speaking lawyers have lost a lot of contributions, and that's why we're silent in many issues. For instance, the role of official languages in the justice system, and we don't have the resources to develop a good argument. And we're all volunteers, and that's not something that you can do when you have a family and your own private practice. So it is important to have those resources that would allow us to work with you, because our organizations also have a role to play. And you have this mandate for promoting. You can't do everything, and we can do something. And sometimes we have a perspective that you don't have, and we could enrich yours. And so give us those resources. We don't want a big yacht, or all we want is a rowboat, you know, and so to get somewhere and to do a lot more and work with you. Thank you, Alexei. Now, Carmen is next, Rex is next, and then Philippe, Raymond, Gino, and Sue. I'll say this. To have an efficient action plan, you need soldiers. We are your soldiers. But, soldiers have to be well fed, right? And no. We don't need weapons. We're peaceful soldiers. With regards to the digital era, the copyright was completely destroyed by the former government, and I hope that the copyright will be restored and give more vitality to those artists who have access to the digital age. Another thing. Regarding official languages, in Canada, we invest a lot in culture, but we don't recognize very much the artistic profession. It's normal to have to recognize engineers, but we should recognize artists as well. There are few provinces who recognize the professional status of the artist, but it's way too few. And I'll just say one thing. In Canada, there is one act where it works half the time, and that's in Quebec. And we have the privilege, and in New Brunswick, to have a federal-provincial workplace for the good of Canada, for all languages involved, so that the artists can live in dignity, have a family, have and do their research with a minimum income. We should have training programs as well. There's some measures about income, too, that should be taken. And unfortunately, in Canada, only the federal government is active, and it doesn't work. Okay? So what we want is a workplace, a laboratory, call it whatever you want, not only for the good of artists of New Brunswick, but for the good of artists all over Canada. Thank you, Carmen.
Yes, in my first time about here, I wanted to establish in the 3 minutes I had that we are in favor, as an Anglophone rights group here in New Brunswick, we are in favor of a fair application of bilingualism. The problem that we're seeing is that Stats Canada states that we are only 15% of our population, the Anglophone majority in this province, only 15% are functionally bilingual. And at the same time, if you go to the site, the federal job or the New Brunswick job posting sites on the internet right now, there is some 471 jobs, of which 70% of them require functionality in French. So I'll leave you to do the math, but I will tell you this much, that underneath the surface of the English-speaking community, there is a boiling anger over that very fact. And I will leave it at that. Thank you.
Thank you, Rex. Next, à la suite, j'avais Philippe.
Philippe is next. Thank you. I'm worried. I want to. when you want to appoint, say, Supreme Court justices, you want them to understand French, read French, but it's not important to be able to speak French. And I'm worried about that. You say bilingual, okay, fine. It means that you understand, but you can't communicate as well in the in your second language. And so think about it, because if we do that for Supreme Court justices, what will that mean for the rest of the application of the Official Languages Act? Because we must have an act as well that that so that judges or justices of the Supreme Court should be required to be bilingual. Another thing, we must not forget all the recommendations that were made that are made by the Official Languages Commissioner. There is work to be done on that side to make sure that we implement those recommendations and have a new dialogue with the commissioner, because there seems to be a frustration with every commissioner, every one of them. And to wrap up, we must make sure that the funding for CBC will also help in-depth information in every region of the Canadian Francophonie. I'm thinking of the Atlantic. We should know what goes on in Newfoundland or in Moncton, and also at the national level, Radio-Canada, Montreal. So I'm going to stop there. I'm going to thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Philippe. We'll break, because we have many comments online. So, Paul, you go ahead.
Linguistic communities and their rights to live, prosper, and grow in the language is vital. And this person referenced to focusing on the economies of those communities to ensure that they remain vital and sustainable. Et le deuxième commentaire, c'est it touches minority papers, more specifically in Quebec, with reference to the fact that the federal government should be encouraged to use these community newspapers in order to promote its programs and services.
Merci, Paul. Donc, on revient.
Thank you, Paul. Raymond, your turn. Yes, I want a few comments. Available services with Justice Canada. The Canadian Association of Universities and Colleges has a project with Justice Canada for the training of all justice professionals. And Judge Cromwell mentioned a few years ago that there was a big problem with the access to justice within Canada. And it's even worse in French as compared to English. So we must train professionals throughout the whole process, as we did with the National Consortium for Health. Over 10 years, we trained hundreds and thousands of people who can work in the health field in French. And we should do the same thing for justice, not just lawyers here. I have no problem with Mr. Couture, but there are so many individuals that are involved in the process, and these people should get that initial training. We're working on that now, but it's an enormous task ahead, if I may. Thank you, Mr. Teberge. I worked with my colleague, the Justice Minister, about the appointment of judges, justices to the Supreme Court, and the for our next workstation for all the ministers responsible for the Francophonie is access to justice. That's our big cause now. We had our last meeting in June, and we talked about economic development, tourism in French. For the 150th anniversary of Canada, we want to have an important legacy here, and we've had very fine support in Alberta, in Ontario, and here with Francine Landry in New Brunswick. They worked very hard with our colleague Jean-Marc Fournier in Quebec. So our next big crusade is access to justice. So if you're interested in that, I'll be interested to hear your point of view and to benefit from your expertise, because that will be an important aspect of the official languages action plan. I'll be discussing that with the Justice Minister, Jody Wilson-Raybould, and I'll be also collaborating with my colleagues like Dominique Leblanc, who's one more ally for us. Gino, you're next. I have a little list too. I was listening to you earlier. You said that your plan was would be based on the vitality of linguistic minority groups and the social cohesion. So I thought about part seven. Jean-Robert Gauthier, the senator, gave it a second wind. Now, some people have a lot of work to do. And the action plan for official languages, you know that Canadian Heritage has the lead, but some other departments have a huge responsibility for the implementation of Part 7. And we're talking about accountability. There was a bit of a slippage here. And if you know about Part 7, you'll agree with me, and Calmen mentioned that. We have to you know, push other departments. And I know the deputy minister, I think he can convince his colleagues. To get back to immigration, it is a big issue for the Francophone Society. It is an economic issue, and congratulations on your work with Mr. Minister McCallum. And I know that all ministers from the Atlantic work on that, and Francophones should be at that table. And when we have discussions with the provinces, I hope that our community will be present. Now, about the collaboration with the French Quebec, we haven't mentioned that. I know that SAIC is partnering with us. So when the programs that you had in Canadian Heritage, there was a partnership with Quebec Anglophones and Francophones outside Quebec. That was the Pelletier Marchand deal. Regarding health, for instance, we have a deal with the University of Sherbrooke, and they cooperate with us in the field of medical training. I think that should be multiplied across the board. Theater as well. We have collaborations here, and René can testify to that, and I think Canadian Heritage could play a more important role. We'll have the census in 2021, or that's not for tomorrow, but in 2001 we did the sampling. 30 seconds? Okay, well, so I think that we were lacking better data to have a better picture of their communities. So if the plan comes out in 2018, for 2021 we should have a game plan. I know it's many years from now. And the last thing I'd like to mention is early childhood. Yes, we must make choices, but the big game here is played when you're 2, 3, 4 years. I know it is a provincial jurisdiction, but I know that there are talks between the two departments, and I think we should have an official languages lens here.
Yes, you have to close your mic after you've spoken. We don't want all the mics open at once. Fine, yes, I'd like to come back to this issue of media that you mentioned earlier. We're talking about young people, and these days we're talking about young people in media especially. And so I would like to point out that the government must be up to date with the media, whether we're talking about younger people or older people. For example, Facebook, my grandmother, well, it's funny to see my grandmother on Facebook, but I think the government came to Facebook when young people decided it was more cool. And so we have to react to that. We have to make it interesting for young people because there are so many small details that we miss but could attract our attention. In order to continue along this line with the media, there's community radio. There was a test done at the University of Moncton, if I'm not mistaken, which explained that small community radios strengthen linguistic security. And that goes back to a comment that was made earlier. And it also strengthens a person's ability to express himself or herself in French. And I listened to radio in English, in my case, and I began to listen to Francophone community radio, and they use the same expressions, and they express themselves in the same way, but I was able to learn what the right words were, what the right terms were. For example, tire and pneu in French, in small ads and so on. And when we say, well, there are tires for sale, if we say it in French, then we're corrected and we know the right word is pneu. So we have to invest in our small communities, and we didn't take it for granted, but it's so important, whether we're talking about young people or older generations, it's very important to emphasize media. And the advisory committee, the youth committee that we're trying to set up, is going to emphasize that we work with and for young people. I'm a young person, but I'm working for the young people in my province. So it would be a good idea if Canada could take note of that and bring it to the national level, because that is something that has so much power. We're talking about being up to date with the media. So you have to ask young people what it means to be up to date with media these days. We're here to help, but I think very often young people are underestimated. And I think that you shouldn't forget us. You have to realize that even at age of 14 or 16, we already have a good idea of what's good for us, what's good for our future, what's good for our parents and grandparents also. Paul? Yes, thank you. Yes, yes, grandfathers also like Facebook. So I'm going to follow up on what Madame Chantal Varin said, and also on what Jean Olivier said earlier. Early childhood. You mustn't forget that in New Brunswick we have a Department of Education Early Childhood, and that's not for nothing, because everything begins in early childhood. For example, young people are beginning to acquire language, to read and so on, and that's where their identity is created, their cultural identity. And we're going to lead them to a stronger Francophone community as a result. So right now, with the lack of openness and accountability, we really don't know where the funds are going. Members are elected by the people, but if we don't have adequate accountability, then we really don't know where to invest the money. So we're getting early childhood here. And I would like to say once again that everything begins in early childhood. And if we do things right, and if we apply criteria on accountability, then I think that could become very important for the development of culture and language. Thank you very much, Paul. So we'll give an opportunity once again to Paul to give us an update on what's happening online, and then I have Justine and Micheline. Yes, thank you. I agree with the gentleman who said that Radio Canada should take into account what takes place across the country, CBC, Radio Canada, and you also have to take into account linguistic minorities. Thank you to the people online, and we'll take your comments into account, even if we don't have time to review them with the people around the table today. Please be assured that your comments have been taken into account. Okay. Yes, the minister mentioned earlier, and Gina mentioned this, the vitality and social cohesion. As far as cohesion is concerned, I think it's important to talk about understanding and mutual appreciation. And it's a challenge in our communities where we see increasing tensions, for example. There is a lack of mutual understanding. And that's also true with Quebec. I lived in Quebec for 5 years, and my favorite story is that in the history course, they taught us about Acadians. They said there were a few left, but that's not mutual understanding. So I think they have to revise that course. First of all, we have to encourage young people to do exchanges. We have an organization consultation at the national level. There are several other organizations that make it possible to work together to allow for these exchanges, and that allows us to get to know one another. Especially in a minority situation, it's important for us to understand there are other people in the same situation. We have colleagues, we have friends across the country, and that makes it possible to know that we're part of something bigger. And as the online comment mentioned, as Philippe mentioned, concerning Radio-Canada, CBC, it's important. I'm tired of hearing about the Champlain Bridge in Montreal. We really don't hear about the Red River in Winnipeg, but everything is concentrated in Montreal. So for CBC Radio-Canada, resources are necessary in order to broadcast public affairs and so on. So it's sad that our society has reached that point that decision is made with taxpayers' money. So we want those resources to be available across the country to reflect our communities across the country. Yes, I have five people on the list who would still like to speak, and we're reaching the end. We have 5 or 6 minutes left, so I would ask people to make their comments very quickly. Please go directly to the point you want to make. And the people I have on the list, Ghislaine, Micheline, Chantal, Carmen, and Patrick, who would like to make a final comment. Ghislaine? Yes, thank you. Yes, to follow up on the importance of development of early childhood, I think that we also have to support the development of literacy programs, family literacy programs, especially where the literacy rate is low. There are a lot of adults who can't help their young children. And in Quebec, we had a parents project that allowed parents to help their young children from 0 to 8 years to help them with family literacy. And we already have data, but what's unfortunate is that we have specific projects, but then at some point, if we don't have the necessary support and the resources to continue, well, age 8, there are new parents, new needs, new families, and so on, and new families to be helped. So we need financing over a longer period, and that would be important if we want to contribute to strengthening the development of early childhood, that is up to age 8. That would be an invaluable tool. Thank you very much, Ghislaine. So very quickly, Micheline. Yes, thank you. I'll try to be brief. As far as the CBC Radio-Canada is concerned, I think supplementary money should be conditional on national coverage. But in order to have national news, I have to go to CBC because there are news shows from Quebec on Radio-Canada. But it's Radio-Canada that determines its audience as being a Quebec audience. So we're somewhat like spies, spying on what's happening in Quebec. We want to know what's happening in our country, in our communities, Anglophone and Francophone. And unfortunately, then we have to turn to English CBC, and perhaps that's an assimilating force. Thank you, Micheline. And Chantal, wanted to add a comment? The other Chantal, sorry. There are two Chantals. Well, several have raised the issue of early childhood. I would like to call for a national policy on early childhood. I think we have the right government to put this into place. As far as accessibility to justice is concerned, in order to answer your question, what I'm hearing from families who contact us, accessibility is quite difficult, especially in Francophone rural areas. 70% of our Francophone population is in a rural area in New Brunswick. So this is a major challenge for those families to have access to justice in French. Thank you very much, Chantal. Now I'm looking in the right place. Carmen? Yes, briefly. Perhaps one thing I would like to tell you, as an Acadian, as a woman, it's true. We're in a minority situation, in the majority, perhaps in my particular area. But as executive director of my organization, there have been administrative boundaries imposed. They want to move around, the people I represent, and I would like to see programs with Quebec. Quebec is our neighbor, and it just doesn't make sense that we're just working in a minority context. I would like to have cooperation with our peers, our colleagues. We have a lot more in common. Unfortunately, there are administrative barriers, administrative boundaries even, and in the future, I would like to work on those boundaries without feeling that we're in a foreign country. Patrick?
Speak after my passionate and articulate friend on the left. I'm glad there was a gap. Dialogue New Brunswick, I think, is uniquely positioned to assist with many of the arguments advanced here today. Our board is representative of the province. In its history, it's brought together about 250,000 visits, contacts, gatherings between young people. And sometimes I say that you got to get the young people together before the parents get a hold of them. And I think they can say, you know, let kids be kids, and let kids from Caraquet meet kids from St. Stephen, and vice versa, and whatever towns need to match up, and a lot can be gained that. And I think our board, our volunteer board, is well positioned to be of assistance. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Patrick. So this is all the time we have today for this roundtable. Now let me say that there's still the survey online. By any means, I invite all of you and people you know. It's a good discussion at the dinner table with the family tonight to go fill out the survey online. Also, send emails. It could be short, it could be longer, by any means. This is not the end of the consultation. This is just the end of this discussion today. So we invite you to continue to chip in. I will let the minister conclude with her remarks for today.
Merci beaucoup. C'est vraiment très...
Thank you very much. It was very interesting to hear your comments and your points of view.
On at Heritage right now, and afterwards I'll go back to the leadership in terms of official languages. So I've had the chance to discuss with many of you in the arts and culture community. We're launching very important consultations this fall on the impact of the web. So basically how to support Canadian content in and how to export Canadian content in a digital age. Dans ces circonstances-là, on va avoir...
So there will be some questions dealing with Radio-Canada, CBC, the Broadcasting Act, Telecommunications Act, the Media Fund, the Music Fund, and so on. All the levers that exist in Canada at the federal level in order to truly support the information environment, film, books, and so on. Anything to do with those aspects. So come in. If you're involved or if you know people who are involved in the area, then I would invite you to participate in these consultations because the model has not been revised since 1992. And there was no internet at that time. There was no smartphone. And all the technological changes we have seen led to different consumption patterns and so on, recreation, entertainment. Everyone across the world is asking how to manage this whole issue of media communication, artists and so on, so people can get access to information in their own community and so on in order to participate in Canadian democracy. And we want to be leaders in developing that model, and that's why it's so important to participate and get involved. And I'll throw out the question of the importance of the media, and I've heard comments about community radio, the content on Radio-Canada, CBC. We're looking at a massive reinvestment in culture and so on, $11 billion, $675 million given to CBC Radio-Canada. And Radio-Canada CBC is an independent entity from the Department of Canadian Heritage. So I don't want to politicize programming, and I know that I have three wishes. And I hope CBC management will take them into account in developing its plan for accountability that they use with the money we give to CBC. That is that there be more local content across the country. Second, that there be digital infrastructure built at CBC Radio-Canada so people can understand how to manage algorithms, big data, and so on. And I hope that Radio-Canada, CBC, in spite of cuts in the past, I hope that with this new investment, they will be able to take into account digital reality. And thirdly, that there be a new generation at Radio-Canada, CBC, that there be young reporters and so on in our newsrooms. The average age now is 52 years old, and we'd like to see a new generation so we can have a strong CBC Radio-Canada for the next 50 years. Another thing I'd like to talk to you about.
Sesquicentennial, so please remember that word. And I will be working on, of course, celebrating across the country, but really leaving a lasting legacy. And in that context, certainly we're making sure that we have great initiatives in New Brunswick, in Atlantic Canada, et puis des projets aussi qui...
And there will also be projects coming out of the Acadian community which support and highlight Acadian heritage. And one of the projects that I announced is the increase of student exchanges in the context of the 150th anniversary. So there will be more student exchanges next year in order to ensure that we can better know reality across the country and linguistic realities across the country. Another thing, going back to leadership in the area of official languages, it goes without saying that I'm in a leadership role, but I'm also in a coordination role. So as a minister of Canadian heritage, my mandate, following on internal conversations and public discussions, I'm told that what is missing clearly is a holistic vision of official languages. The current government has a more open approach. The former government had a more solid approach. There was a reduction of money and so on. If we look at CBC Radio-Canada, there was a 40% reduction in heritage operations during that time, and it certainly had an impact. And that's why it's important for me to have allies such as Dominique Leblanc, who's here with me today, or Scott Bryson, chairman of the Treasury Board. It was important for them. He was in Halifax, Marc Bibeau in Sherbrooke, John McGraw in Quebec, Barty Steger in Waterloo. So across the country, that's exactly what we're doing. And my colleagues, ministers, and members of caucus who do not necessarily wear the hat of Canadian heritage also have to work on a development of public policy and so on, and they have to be aware of the reality of linguistic communities across the country. So you can rest assured that there will be an action plan and that the official languages lens will be very much present when the cabinet discusses the different issues. And it's, of course, a concern for us. Another thing also, in the context of launching the Digital Challenges Program, I asked my team whether it would be possible to open up the possibility of including Section 7 in the Digital Challenges Program. That would be very important, because that would ensure that linguistic rights, along with the vitality of cultural communities, be protected. And I'm aware of the impact of opening up that possibility, but it's something that I would find positive for our communities. Also, as far as early childhood is concerned, we talked a lot about early childhood. And the government launched a major program, and it was one of the greatest openings in terms of universality, opening up health care and education, and talking about the childhood benefit. It was launched in July, and it's offered to all middle-class families. Now, we're also aware that we have a role to play in supporting social infrastructure. And I hear a lot about early childhood across the country, but in a context of adding to the official languages lens relative to our investments, our vision is to ensure that we support community infrastructure for linguistic communities in a minority situation. And I heard you talk about justice, health, immigration, and if there's anything else you would like to raise, please don't hesitate to get in contact with us through Paul Landry, through Canadian Heritage here in Moncton, or obviously you can consult your brilliant MP, the brilliant minister, or myself through social media, and I would be happy to answer you, and we can continue this wonderful discussion. Thank you very much.
On vous demanderait ceux qui sont présents. Si...
So, if you would stay for a picture, perhaps we can set up for a picture before you leave. Perhaps here in front would be better, and perhaps you could come to the front of the room and take your place, and we'll take a picture.